It's telling that one of the most popular topics we've tackled in the past few years is anxiety. Anxiety disorders affect 16% of the Australian population in any one year. The good news is it's treatable. Have a look. Hi, thanks for joining us. It's the most common reason people seek professional help. Panic attacks, irrational fears, an inability to function properly at home, socially, or at work. We've all felt anxious from time to time, but what makes that tip into something much more crippling? Why do so many people get anxiety disorders? What are they? How do you treat them? And can they be cured? That's what we're talking about tonight. Don't forget you can join us via Twitter. And welcome to everyone here. We will try to make this studio as relaxing as we possibly can tonight. Simon Palomares, you're an actor. You're a stand-up comedian. When you were in Wogs Out of Work, I think you were performing in front of sometimes 1,500 people a night. But what made you anxious?
The weird thing was actually walking off the stage and not being able to walk through the foyer or basically into the car and straight home. So it was actually dealing with, I think it was just dealing with people that in an uncontrolled manner.
So you were fine in front of all those people on
stage?
Oh, that
was easy. Yeah, that was easy. Yeah. That part was easy. It was actually just going home. There was a whole stack of different things. A lot of it had to do with stress, with depression, it was sort of like a trilogy of terror. It was an inability to cope with anything new coming into my world. So there was the letterbox or the telephone. I'm not sure how I could cope with that now, because now you've got email and Twitter and every other sort of way of bad news sort of reaching you. But it was
Was it about bad news reaching?
It was about not being able to cope with new with a new trauma or a new something that would make me anxious that would have to deal with, that I wouldn't be able to cope with, and then that then led to not going into the streets, and you know, that basically my world just became smaller.
I want to show a clip of you just so people can get a sense of how confident you are as a performer. And this is just a short clip of you performing in Spain, talking about teenage boys, I think inspired by your son. So let's have a look.
No sé lo que pasa ahí, empiezan a cambiar, el cuerpo crecen, en seis meses han crecido medio metro, pero no todo de una vez, ¡pum! Las piernas, ¡pum, pum, pum! Los brazos, ¡pum, pum! ¿No? Y ya, y tiene este cuerpo que no lo saben usar todavía, ¿no? ¿Habéis visto en la calle? Pasa la puerta del sol. Las hormonas empiezan a saltar, empiezan a crecer de perlos. Pero perlos no esperaban crecer, ¿no? Luego empiezan a sacar pelos porque ni te imaginas que van a tener pelos. Yo te digo, pero tío, mira, mira, será huella, todo esto será vuestro, todo esto.
See, I find that so interesting, because a lot of people have performance anxiety. They worry about performing on stage. They freeze. They can't do it. You clearly could do that.
Yeah. Well, to me, that was my job. You know, and I think that's what happens with a lot of people. They go to work, you know, in a bank or you know, doing all sorts of amazing jobs, and then they go home and basically lock themselves up, because they just go from one safe place to another.
How bad did it get for you? I mean, at its worst, what was it like?
At its worst, it eventually led to a major depression and, you know, quite a severe nervous breakdown, to the point that, and once sort of like the whole thing, my whole world collapsed, it got to the point of it was like a living nightmare. You know, it was like having nightmares while you were awake. And getting to the point, you know, where you wanted to die to stop feeling the fear, because it wasn't, you know, and that's then when sort of heavy treatment had to come in
and go into antidepressants.
I was a basket case by the time that, you know, I had a breakdown, the you know, everything stopped. I couldn't even walk out of the house. But the thing is, you know, is that weird thing. People sort of are afraid that they're going to cross the line, sort of insanity, and there is no line. You know, suddenly one day is, you know, you put up with these levels of stress in your life, and you keep pushing yourself, and you think, no, I'm okay. I can't stand this phrase. It's all good. When people walk around with this great big smile on their face,
It's all good.
You know,
it's never all good.
It's never all good. Life is never all good. You know, for me, the hardest thing was actually finding out what I needed to be anxious of, and was normal.
Karen, I'd like to talk to you because you're the General Manager of Human Resources for the RTA, which is the Roads and Traffic Authority for people interstate who might not know. You regularly had to give staff presentations as a human resources manager. Now, what was that like?
I would not eat the night before a presentation, even if the presentation was at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So I would set myself into a spiral. People told me I presented quite well, but it was what it did to me. I would fear that I wouldn't get my message across or I wouldn't honour the message I was giving.
And was this big groups of people or small groups?
It could be large groups, it could be small groups, it could be just a meeting. The biggest fear was actually being physically ill during a presentation.
Actually vomiting in front of everybody?
I'm afraid so.
Because that's what you felt like, yeah?
Absolutely.
Did you ever do that?
No. Pleased to say I kept myself very tidy about that.
So what were you actually frightened? That was the thing you were most frightened of?
I think it was the thing I was most frightened of, and not looking very professional, fearing that someone might say, well, she's really not General Manager Human Resources material and take the job away.
Ah, okay.
But,
so
yeah.
So maybe it was partly about wondering whether you deserve to be there or should
quite
have been
possibly
there?
yeah.
How long did this go on for?
It went on for I'd say quite a few years until I was able to do a program that helped me with my fear and my anxiety.
Amanda, I want to talk to you because you loved debating at school, didn't you?
Yeah.
Did that make you anxious?
No, not at all. I've never really been scared of public speaking. It was more social situations where I didn't have control over what people actually thought of me and people's other impressions of me. I think that was what really scared me, how other people would actually perceive me and think of what I was like as a person, rather than just, say, as a team member or as somebody who was part of an argument.
Who had a role
yeah.
of some kind. When did that anxiety start for you? Do you remember?
It started in about grade four. It went for several years.
How bad did that get for you?
It got to the point I couldn't go out in public. You know, social situations became just the scariest thing for me. I couldn't handle any of it.
So a real fear of disapproval
yeah.
was at the centre of it.
Yeah.
Caitlin, you play the clarinet, is that yeah. right? How do you feel just before you perform?
Nervous. Because I don't like it. Because I'm not a fan of performing at all, really. So.
And what describe for me what that's like. If you know that you've got to perform in an exam or something like that, I mean, what's that feeling like for you?
It's hard to describe, but I try and get out of it as much as I can.
You really. Try to avoid it. Can you relate to the things that some of the people here have been describing about how they mm-hmm. feel? Are they some of the things that you feel?
Yeah.
And is it just in that situation or in other situations as well for you?
I don't like doing speeches or debating either because I'm not good at them.
How bad does that get for you when you feel really consumed by it, when you feel like you can't, you know, how bad does that feeling get for you?
Pretty bad depending on what the situation is.
Gavin Andrews, you're a psychiatrist, you're head of the St Vincent's Anxiety Clinic in Sydney. What's the difference between being anxious about something understandable, you know, like a public performance, like being here, you know, telling your story, and an anxiety disorder? What is the difference? Because most of us feel anxious at some stage.
All disorders really are dimensional. That is, they work from it's normal to be anxious in scary situations, and as we talked about, your body changes to enable you to cope with that scary situation. It becomes a disorder when it lasts for inappropriate lengths of time, so that it's their day, this day, that day, and it becomes a disorder when it stops you doing what you have to do, working and loving. You could work, but at great pain, but the rest of your life was not great, very clearly. So that's it.
And why can people get really anxious about some things, like Simon being anxious about walking through the foyer after a performance, but not be anxious about being on display in front of 1,500 people who might judge him? You know, they might judge his...
But they weren't judging the real Simon, they were judging Simon the performance. Mm. Just as we're not judging you as the real person, because we don't know you.
Glad to hear
and
it.
When he walked through the foyer, he's Simon, the real person. And someone might come up and say, "Didn't like that. How are you?" And he's in trouble.
I mean, that's Caitlin, this is the issue. It's different. You know, Caitlin feels very much, very anxious about being judged about performance. So you do get people who find that much more difficult. And Karen too, very anxious about giving a presentation, which isn't Karen. That's Karen as a human resources manager, but it's not the person.
But Karen's central core issue was that she might be judged negatively, and therefore the corollary of that, not suitable for my job. Please exit stage left. Do not complain. Boy, that's a rough punishment. Mm. So that's worth getting anxious about. That was the issue.
OK, what are the most common types of anxiety disorders?
The commonest is probably worry disorder, called generalised anxiety disorder. Panic disorder, agoraphobia, social phobia, and those are the three common ones. There's also obsessive compulsive disorder, and there's post-traumatic stress disorder, and there are specific phobias that kids have of heights and closed spaces and dark and so on. My God, I'm anxious. I'll bite my lip.
Just breathe. Just breathe, Gavin. And I'm not making light of this. I'm, you know, just trying to kind of lighten things up a bit. But thanks, Sarah, you're a psychologist and you've got a private practice. How often do you see this sort of thing? How common is it?
Look, anxiety disorders by far and away are the most common disorders that we see in private practice. Something like 15% of the population suffer from an anxiety disorder each year, which is absolutely massive. So in a way, I think even though most of the people here are prone to anxiety or feeling anxious, we're not that unusual because much of the population suffers from anxiety and anxiety disorders.
And what sort of things can happen to the body in those situations?
Anxiety is a perception of threat. So brain perceives threat. Something bad's going to happen. Brain sends a message to the adrenal gland. The adrenal glands spurt out adrenaline. We get high levels of arousal, high levels of activation. Muscles become tense, hearts pounding. Sometimes chest is tight. We also see things like dizziness and nausea and a whole series of physical symptoms that sometimes people suffer from as a result of anxiety.
So how many people in the community, what proportion could expect to have, say, a panic attack at some point in their lives?
Panic attacks are extremely common. I can't remember the exact statistic, but it's something like 15% of the population will suffer from a panic attack at some stage.
And we're not just talking about a mild sense of panic here.
No, a full-blown panic attack is extremely scary. So when people have a panic attack, the entire body goes into a very intense stage of fight or flight. So it feels like you might run out of air. It feels like you could faint. It feels like you could die. People worry that they might go mad. People worry that they're going to have a heart attack or something terrible is about to happen. So it's a really scary experience to have.
Barbara, tell us what happened to you 10 years ago when you were driving your car.
Yeah, for no apparent reason, I all of a sudden was overcome with an amazing sense of fear and the thought that I was just going to die. And it was so strong. And I was gripping the steering wheel and I seemed to go into like a trance and just amazing fear.
And any sense of why when you were driving this would happen rather than at some other point in your life or in other situations?
Look, in other situations I'm totally fine. I love public speaking. I do it all the time. I'm a teacher, so it's my job. Doesn't bother me at all speaking in front of large amounts of people. I love flying, you know, pretty well anything else, but driving on freeways and highways, no. Nah. And in the country, unfamiliar roads, yeah, is the only time I get it.
Sarah, is there any connection between driving and having a panic attack? Because I've heard a few stories of people having them while they're
driving. And also flying. So we often hear people having panic attacks when they're flying or being terrified of flying. I think one of the problems is once it happens once and you're aware that it's happened in this place, you become then quite vigilant and highly aroused as soon as you get in the car. Now, there are some places when you're driving that are particularly scary for most people. And if you're in a very busy area or you're on a freeway where it would be particularly hard to stop and where you're surrounded by lots of traffic, you're already highly anxious then, and so you're much more likely or you're primed to have a panic attack because the body's already on high alert
Barbara,
and it doesn't take
you're agreeing with that, yeah?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, if you're on a freeway, especially if you're on the sort of far lane, you know, you can't stop. You can't sort of get out of the situation. Whereas if you're on a normal kind of road, you can stop or turn around the corner and get out of it.
It's really interesting. Is there always a trigger, Gavin, or a tipping point or a trigger of some... Is there always an explanation behind this?
Yeah, mostly. I mean, that's one of the interesting things, and that's a nice experience. Oh, sorry, it was a lousy experience, but it's a nice description. Because really the issue for you is that if you're worried about your body imploding, because that's the core issue... If you on the Moonee Bridge, you have Buckley's chance of either escaping or help getting to you until you're dead. Yeah, and so
thank you for that, for all the people who travel Moonee Bridge every day.
With me.
Okay, is there a particular type of person who's prone to an anxiety disorder?
Anxiety disorders are most common in people who are born with high levels, who are nice and bubbly and reactive and highly sensitive, so that you have a personality that alarms quickly and it becomes uncontrollable quickly. It's very rare for a professional stoic to develop an anxiety disorder. That's why I like dealing with anxiety disorders, the people are reactive and interesting. People with anxiety disorders also have often had a pretty rough trot in childhood. Traumas in those families, because it's partly genetic, but traumas in those families are more than people's fair share. So although they may motor through into their 20s intact, they remain vulnerable because they arouse so quickly and because the arousal reminds them that bad things happen.
Coming up, we're going to look at how much of anxiety is genetic and how much is learned. That's next on Insight. Tonight we're talking about anxiety disorders. And Kate, tell us your story. Tell us about your anxiety and how it manifests itself.
Mum tells me that as a child I was probably a little bit sensitive, so there were probably some indicators earlier on of that sensitive nature. But it really sort of all came to a head, I guess, when I was about 15. We had a lot of changes in our family, some big changes happened, and Mum got to a point where they were a bit hard for her to cope with, and she started to have some pretty serious panic attacks. And then for probably about 3 months after that, Mum found it pretty hard to face the day, pretty much every day. So I just sort of stepped in. I was doing school at home at the time, stepped in with my younger sisters, and soon after that, started to develop what I now know are obsessive compulsive tendencies.
So you were about 15 when that started?
Yes.
Okay, and what are those obsessive compulsive tendencies?
Yeah,
what do you do?
When I was about 15, it started with the hand washing, which I know is very common. And then it started fear of germs. I got very particular about sort of my food and who prepared my food, who touched it, what it had touched, to the point where I wouldn't even touch my food before it went into my mouth, you know, with my hands and things like that. And then just it sort of progressed to absurd fears about things that could happen.
And Greta, how long have you had anxiety?
I think I've had it on and off for nearly all my life. I think when I think back and listening to everyone, the little bits and pieces, is really, really interesting. Listening to the worry. I was a worry child, worried about everything and other people, their feelings. Didn't want to upset anyone, didn't want to hurt anyone. I think I went through that, and I think that, and even just the isolation when I was younger. I was a very young mum, and I would not go outside and put clothes on the line. I would wait for night time. I know that sounds funny, but I'd wait for night time and put them on, and then night time to go and take them off. I didn't want anyone to see me.
Why didn't you want anyone to see you?
I just didn't want anyone to see me. I don't know.
And the two of you, I mean, how much control, if any, do you feel you have over this now?
I guess I don't ever feel it got to a point for me where, you know, it got to the same extreme as mum's experience. So I feel I still struggle with those obsessive thoughts today, you know, switching light switches and keys in the car and that sort of stuff. So I feel like I've got it under control, but I still battle with it on a day-to-day basis.
You never know if the next day is going to be good or bad. It just seems to come out of nowhere sometimes, and it's, you just don't know.
Sarah, you had your hand up. I mean, what do you make of a story
like
this? Yeah,
I think it's actually quite typical. Very frequently, anxious parents tend to have anxious kids because they pass on their biological or genetic disposition, but they also model behaviour to some degree. And we learn anxiety to some degree from family environments, as well as, I guess, getting the genes as well. So it's quite common.
Gavin, how much do you think is learned and how much is inherited?
Oh, 50-50. 50% of the liability to anxiety is under genetic control, is the usual claim. A quarter is probably due to, exactly as you say, children grow up without being taught the skills to manage their anxiety. And a quarter comes from wherever a quarter comes from in this miserable world. Random events that occur to you.
Amanda, do you have any sense of what triggered your anxiety or where it might come from for someone so young? Were your parents anxious?
Mum and Dad didn't really have, you know, much anxiety or anything. I guess I'm one of those sensitive people. You know, I've always been what, you know, anyone else would call over-emotional. You know, I was the kid who would get a splinter and, you know, I'd have to be given a lollipop to shove in my mouth so that I'd be quiet while mum and dad could pull the splinter out, sort of thing. You know, I'd have to be bribed for the simplest little things, you know, overreact to the maximum possible capacity. But, you know...
Did you tell your parents about it?
I think I tried, but I think to a point mum and dad were in denial a bit. Also, so, you know, they didn't seem to really understand what I was going through, so I just put a mask on and pretended that nothing was wrong, really. You know?
So how did it come to a head then?
I guess I had high expectations for grade 12, and I think I'm one of those people who always puts things on a pedestal and then they don't quite turn out the way you think. It got to the point where I actually tried to commit suicide because I couldn't handle it anymore. I wanted to get out. I didn't want to have to put up with it every day. I didn't want to have to keep on, you know, plastering this mask on, pretending that everything was okay, because the more you put the mask on, people don't realise, so they don't ask you if you're all right, you know, so it seems like they don't care, which, you know, doesn't help with the whole, oh, no one cares about me in the first place, and so you put a mask on, but then people still don't care.
So what happened then when it got to that point where you attempted suicide? What happened after that?
I just got away for a couple of days. I actually flew down to Sydney with my dad because he works down here a lot. Just to get away from it all, and when I got back I tried going back to school just for little bits of the day, and it just got worse to the point where I left school completely and I finished grade 12 through distance education because I couldn't be around people. You know, I'd shut myself in my room all day every day and just keep to myself because I couldn't handle any excess, you know, pressure or people from outside coming into my world and, you know, turning upside down what I thought was true and what wasn't. It was... Yeah, handle social situations. Now, I have my days. It's a lot better. I saw the Queensland Child and Youth Mental Health Service, and they were absolutely amazing. I did an acceptance and commitment therapy, which really helped me to be able to actually grasp that a lot of the thoughts that were going through my mind weren't actually all that true.
Hmm. Paul, I know that you've had social anxiety for as long as you can remember, haven't you? And very crippling social anxiety. What was school like for you, if you remember back to that?
Well, I had my first real anxiety attack when I was 15, in year 10. But before that, I had other difficulties. Right from my first year of school was very difficult for me. I had actually been taken out of school and learned how to socialise. And I was... So that was very difficult. But when I came to 15 years of age, I had anxiety attacks that seemed to come from nowhere. And they were very frightening because there was no reason for them to occur. So I couldn't see any outside fear that was causing them. So, yeah, that was very frightening.
How bad did it get for you?
It got to a point where I locked myself into a flat for about my 5 years. I found it very difficult getting out of my flat during the day. I actually found it easier getting out of my flat at night time. So I would actually exercise at, go for walks.
No, hanging out the washing at night. I mean, it's the same idea, isn't it?
Because at night time you don't have people looking at you. And at night time it's also associated with relaxation. Like you work during the day and you relax at night time. So the anxiety is actually not as bad during the night.
And was that for a reason? Like, was there something that had happened in your childhood that you think had triggered this or not?
Well, it's hard to really... I've tried to understand the past, but it's really hard to connect the dots because you're going back to a time when it's your memory is still very vague. And I tried that for a psychiatrist for a number of years, and I found that not to be very beneficial in the end. I find looking at the future and trying to develop, make that a good future happen for yourself is far more valuable than trying to work out the past and what's happened in the past.
And now?
I see a lot of ways getting better, actually. Yeah. One of the things that's really helped me is to be in a group of people who understand, so that when you actually have the anxiety, you don't feel judged so much. So you can actually experience the anxiety and then just let it happen. And then you can accept it. Accepting it is very important in dealing with anxiety.
Ron, you're a psychologist and you work with parents and children, with children who suffer from anxiety. What do you make of this, about how much of, you know, if you're seeing anxiety in a small child, as we've heard with some of these cases tonight, I mean, how often is there a cause? Is there something traumatic at the heart of that? And how often is it inherited? And how often does it have no real explanation?
I think, as we've been saying, the genetic part of it is massive. It's a type of problem which is heavily inherited. We see that all the time in our programs with the anxious children. You can often get the sense when you walk into the room, we run a lot of our treatments in groups, and when you first walk into the room on that first session, you can almost cut the air with a knife. There's that tension all around that's shared between the parents and the children and everyone. And so it is something that is very much passed on between families.
And a lot of parents worry about their children being anxious.
Absolutely.
But I wonder, what are the things to look for in a child? I mean, which is different from a child just worrying about something or having a normal childhood fear, or, you know, becoming obsessed for a short time about something and being really fearful of it. What are the things you should actually look out for?
Children, very sadly, children will say a lot of the same sorts of things as adults. So all that catastrophizing, all those extreme thoughts that a lot of the people here have been talking about, that fear that others are judging me, the worry about the world ending, worries about catastrophes, etc. Those things are all things that children will say. They'll say them in their own world. So they might talk about catastrophes at school or catastrophes at sport.
But they mimic.
But they will say the same sorts of things.
Mm. So parents can contribute to it a lot.
Parents can contribute, but parents will also hear their children saying those. And as we were saying before, the bottom line is it's really about when that worry and anxiety starts to affect the child's life.
Does it help if you get it early?
It helps to get it early because, as we've been saying in a lot of this conversation, anxiety is often a sort of a long-term problem, and it tends to go on in people if it's untreated for many, many years. So getting it early is important because it helps a person rediscover their life and re-establish their goals and potential.
And how do you treat it?
We treat it in kids the same way as in adults. The very first thing is to try to change the way that people are looking at the world, their beliefs, their ideas, the things that a lot of the people here have been saying. It's realising that you're not the centre of the world. It's realising that people are not judging you badly. It's realising that you're not going to die of that heart attack. That's the first step. And then the second step is the old adage of just do it. There's no good way around it. It's just getting out there. It's doing things that you're scared of. It's approaching those situations, facing your fears over and over and over again.
Okay, Karen, I wanted to talk to you because your daughter Caitlin went through the Cool Kids program.
Yes.
that Ron runs, and you went along too. I wonder what it taught you as a parent.
I'd like to apologise first to Caitlin because I think she's got my 50% of the anxiety genes. But the Cool Kids group taught us some practical things as a family, certainly that it was a physical reaction to a situation, and gave us some tools to use. So realistic thinking, I think, was one of the things that I found really helpful for me. And the tie between the physical ailments that Caitlin was feeling, because she was feeling sick when she was scared, so she was taking time off school or whatever to avoid those situations. She thought she was sick. We knew that she was anxious, but when that penny dropped for her, it really helped.
Mm. Did it help, Caitlin?
A lot, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. Did you think that you had, apart from your genes, giving you your genes, did you in any sense think that you might have contributed to her anxiety just with things that you did or said or the way that you treated her? Was there any sense of that?
Look, before we went to the course, we probably didn't think it was so much us. But yeah, we did. Once we realised that, because for Caitlin, it's not just performance. She wouldn't use the telephone. She didn't like sleepovers, sorry, pet, things like that. Socially, you could see it was affecting her life, and I just didn't want her to end up not living her life to the full. Mm. And so when we realised that partly we were to blame because we were protecting her and talking for her and just covering for her, once we stopped that, it...
Mm. And Craig, how did you find that whole process?
Yeah, look, I'd say it was good from that point of view. I guess we went through the language, I guess, of what we were doing. But yeah, I guess we also found out that we were, as Karen said, enabling in some respects, because when Caitlin came and said, look, I don't want to do sport, I've got a sore knee this week, you were pretty sure she didn't have a sore knee, but you'd end up giving her that note, which was only making things worse. We weren't getting out and, I guess, confronting the issues that needed to be faced at the time. So it was a good process to go through, and I think the realistic thinking was good. We went to one at the local shopping centre out at Macquarie Centre, and in terms of understanding that people don't really give a toss about what you're doing, we had to go out and dress in sort of, you know, funny clothes and do stupid things, you know, ride the escalators the wrong way and just point at the ceiling, and no one cared what you're doing.
No one cared.
and so you've got this perception that if I don't do X, Y and Z, that people are going to think I'm a fool or whatever it may be, and you realise that you can be, to a point, outrageous.
Yeah. And that was
no one cares because they're in their own world. They're going and doing their shopping. They're coming home from work or wherever it may be.
Don't care that much.
And you
about
can just
you.
Get on yeah. with what you want to do. Yeah.
Gavin, are you seeing more anxiety in young people, particularly? Is there more anxiety? Because I know when we asked around about this, you know, everybody said, "Oh, yes, you know, there's a lot more anxiety these days." And I had a bit of resistance to that because I thought, "Yeah, well, you know, my mother grew up during the Second World War. I mean, you know, had her life during the Second World War and the Depression, and I just think, is it?
No.
Is it worse now?
How about a one-word answer? No. There's no more, as far as we can judge, and we're talking about multiple national mental health surveys in multiple countries, there is no increase in anxiety disorders. There are differences in the instruments that people use and they get different figures. But when push comes to shove, I don't think there's more anxiety around. We actually live in a much safer society than your parents did. There is no war and there's a lot less starvation than there was in the Depression. And according to the Sydney Morning Herald, the crime rate is collapsing. Home burglaries are down, they don't steal your car and they don't bash you up quite as much. So, you know, it's a pretty nice world we live in. So anxiety is not increasing. We say it's inside you. It's not the event that causes the anxiety. It's what you think about the event. So it's the inside of your head that's the enemy.
Coming up, we're going to talk more about how to treat anxiety and possibly cure it. Tonight we're talking about anxiety, and let's talk about some more about treatment, because I think that's what a lot of people at home are going to want to hear about. Gavin, is an anxious person always going to be anxious, or can you cure it?
Two questions there. As you grow older, you actually grow calmer. So if without treatment, the severity of what hits you will gradually go off. The prevalence of anxiety disorders is 2, 3, 4 times higher in the 20-year-olds than it is in the 70-year-olds. So that's nice.
Good news.
What did you say?
Good news.
Yeah. Good news for Paul, okay.
And the next bit is, although there's this genetic underpinning, you actually can cure people with anxiety. It's the most treatable of all the mental disorders. That's why Ron and you and I are in this game. We get rewarded. Well, there are the two standard treatments. There are medications, the antidepressant drugs. They are weak treatments, and the real problem is that people don't take them. They hate them, basically. But they do cut the edge of your anxiety. The three of us are into cognitive behaviour therapy, and we've all been saying what it is. It's not the event, it's what you think about it. So let's help you restructure your thinking. The way to do that properly is to confront the event and work out what's happened and go, I managed that. You confront it in a planned way, doing the bits you can manage and building up to the stuff that used to terrify you. Mm. And that's simple skills that you learn and master.
Now, you're doing this online now.
I'm doing this online
now. Yeah, and we've got some examples of what you do here. I just wonder if you could talk us through how your online program works, your online treatment program works.
Sure. We diagnose people and make certain that they have the disorder. And then they log in and there are 6 lessons. And they look at a cartoon story of someone like them with their disorder who's doing what I've just been talking about and recovers over the 6 lessons. Backed with a cartoon story is all the very traditional stuff, which we call homework, the written stuff, but the cartoon is the hook because they identify with the person and go, yes.
See, I find this fascinating. So this whole idea of having to sit with a therapist or with somebody for hours and hours and hours and hours, you're saying you can actually deal with some of this online quite effectively?
We've now treated 1,000 people with anxiety disorders. About 3/4 of them are better. 6 months later, they're even more better. That doesn't sound like English. they go on improving. And that's very exciting. We're teaching them skills that they learn and use. And we do this in panic disorder, we do it in social phobia, and we do it in worry disorder. 10 weeks and you're better.
10 weeks and you're better.
10 weeks and you're better, 6 lessons, needing about an hour of therapist time, just to encourage you. In fact, our clinic manager is just as good as our best therapist. So the three of us are out of business.
Sarah?
Yes, I think it's one of the most exciting developments in mental health treatment, and that's the internet therapy, because one of the problems with psychology and clinical psychology is that it's not accessible to everyone, partly because of the costs and partly just because of location. So the thing about anxiety is if people are relatively uncomplicated, I think internet therapy is a really effective treatment. It's one of the reasons I love doing anxiety. I think anxiety is generally a very exciting area to treat because most people respond. If you actually follow the treatment, as long as they comply with the homework and you sort of follow the standard formula, if you like, most people get better.
And yet for people living inside that anxious state, it feels impossible to treat, presumably. Yeah. Amanda,
Something I found really useful was with the therapy that I did, it was all about, you know, changing your mindset and everything. And one of the best things I found was I did this one lesson this one week, and I can't even remember what it was called, but it was fantastic. Basically, I had to pick a thought that was like, you know, really resonated, that, you know, would go through my head all the time. And that one thought for me was, I'm not worth it. You know, no one wants me here. I'm just not worth being here. And, you know, I had to, during the next week, I had to, every time that thought would come into my head, I had to sing it, like, you know, or say it in a silly voice, put on an accent, you know. I had to draw it on a piece of paper and then put, you know, decorations all around it so it looked like, you know, a happy birthday banner that you'd have up. Or I had to sing the words, I'm not worth it, to happy birthday, or twinkle, twinkle, little star.
What are you doing
now? Because it makes the thought sound ridiculous. You know, singing I'm not worth it to happy birthday, it makes it sound like the most ridiculous thing on the face of the earth, which in turn makes you laugh about it.
So it's putting it there.
It's putting it out there and looking at it and going, hang on, that's just ridiculous. Why would I even think that? Because it's not true. You know, putting it in that ridiculous sense makes it seem so much less of an issue.
Yeah, Kate.
That's a strategy that that I started to use when I was about 17. And I don't know where it came from or how I started doing it, but I would do that very thing. I would just play devil's advocate with my own thoughts, you know, that's rubbish, you know, that's ridiculous. Or sometimes I would say things out loud to myself, or just do something, you know, just to interrupt that thought pattern, and so that I could then move on and that fear would you know, dissipate.
Adam, tell us about your research and the trials that you've done with social anxiety. What are you finding?
We look at new medications which are thought to help people learn to overcome fears. So we have, we're trialling two different medications at the moment, which aim to help people during therapy believe what they fear is actually quite safe. So we're looking at D-cycloserine and oxytocin.
And what is oxytocin?
Oxytocin is a hormone that's produced naturally in the body. It's traditionally been referred to as a love hormone that's involved in bonding and caregiving and reproduction.
And orgasm,
that's right.
You weren't going to say that, but
no,
I was.
Not on national
television. I was. So explain the connection then.
Well, and one of the things that we've become very interested in is how oxytocin might help people respond in social situations. And what we've found is it actually makes people more accurate in identifying and understanding other people in the trials that we've conducted in our international collaborators. So one of the things that we're doing at the moment is looking at how drugs like oxytocin and cycloserine could potentially facilitate the therapy process by helping people to understand the social setting more effectively and to learn to cope in new ways.
Gavin, response to that idea?
How dare he? We can't use drugs over the web, obviously. But if we're getting three-quarters of the people better in 10 weeks with an hour of technician time or nurse time, we don't need him. 3 years ago, we were in a group together. We applied for a grant together, which we failed to get, because at that stage, I needed him. Not anymore.
Whoa, OK. All right, this is getting really interesting. We're going to have to wrap up in a moment. Ron.
Sorry, I was just going to add to Gavin that if you could teach the computer to dispense the pills, then you'd have a really good program.
Adam?
I've got a really good program.
Gavin's got an amazing program, but it is a program which produces rates like no other internationally. I mean, the majority of CBT programs aren't that effective, and there is a high relapse rate. And so more effective strategies are needed.
And Gavin, I think, yeah. What do you think of drug treatments of the drug? You know, what's your view of the drugs that are available?
They're not very good. That's my view of them. The benzodiazepines you should never take for anxiety. You get habituated and you are not very accurate in the morning driving your car. The SSRIs are not strong treatments. They're helpful if that's all you can get. Really, we think we reach 90% of people with anxiety disorders. If we match our people against the National Mental Health Surveys, we are matching, reaching, benefiting 90%. So that's great.
Sarah?
I actually want to give you a plug for Adam's research, because I've actually read some of the papers that he's produced and other researchers have produced, and it may be a little bit complex, but I want to put it in a very simple way. There are some people who, when we do exposure, so when people are anxious, an important part of the treatment is exposure, getting them to repeatedly confront the situations that they fear. Most people get a reduction in anxiety over time, but there are some people, because they have very complex presentations, who don't habituate very well, who have real problems with habituating. And this is where one of the drugs that I can't say because it's a long name, but one of the drugs that Adam's been evaluating has actually found that if people actually take that drug, it's actually an antibiotic as far as I understand that's used for TB, but at a fairly small dose, actually helps the brain to recall the positive experience of the previous exposure.
Okay, what's the drug, Adam?
Sarah, I think Sarah's talking about D-cycloserine, but the point I'd like to make is that, you know, mental health treatments are
evolving.
Could
you say that again?
I'll get 1,000 people contacting me for the drug. the drug that is being trialled and is called D-cycloserine on a trial basis. But I mean, I'd just like to emphasise that mental health treatments and our understanding of mental health disorders is changing, and we're beginning to understand that the brain can evolve and can adapt new ways of learning. And these medications are not like benzodiazepines, they're not like antidepressants, which are supposedly, their aim is to sort of lift mood or take away the anxiety. Their aim is to facilitate learning, and it's a very different process, and it isn't like a safety cue. It doesn't make people feel safe. It helps them to learn a new way of overcoming their fears. Mm.
Just a quick question I wanted to ask about the benefits of therapy, you know, lots and lots of psychotherapy and things like that for anxiety. Is it of any use at all? Does it work, Gavin?
No.
No?
No.
All right. Yeah, Sarah, what do you think?
Just to clarify, people often confuse what we mean with psychotherapy, and what you're talking about, I think, is just spending time talking about the past, making
your
sense
childhood,
of
bad
understanding why. I think sometimes it's useful to make sense of why we respond the way we do and why we behave the way we do, but there's certainly very little evidence in the research that in itself can help to resolve anxiety disorders. Mm-hmm. That in the end, we still need to learn the tools to be able to manage anxiety.
Can anxiety be good for you?
Of course, it's essential. That's how we learn to cope with danger. That's how we learn to cope with risk. Anxiety facilitates performance and judgment, facilitates a whole range of things. It's only when the anxiety is too extreme that it debilitates and robs capacity for you to cope.
So, and is there a danger then of pathologizing anxiety to the point where if you focus on it too much, you make it worse? You know, if you spend too much time talking to somebody about something they feel anxious about, it actually reinforces the anxiety rather than helps it.
Yes.
She's my friend.
go, Amanda.
I saw a therapist for a few months, you know, on a weekly basis, talking about my feelings, and, you know, you get that typical sort of psychologist, and how does that make you feel sort of question. And I would leave every week feeling worse than I did when I got there, because it didn't help me at all. You know, all it did was reinforce all these horrible thoughts and experiences that I'd had and make them worse. You know, you pay so much money for an hour-long session, and it doesn't seem to do anything. But as soon as I got some practical help on, you know, all right, this is the problem, what can we do to fix it? That is so much more effective than just going, how do you feel?
Kevin?
Okay, I now understand the question, thank you. You cannot create an anxiety disorder in a person that doesn't have one by talking to them about anxiety. No one will develop, watching this program, will develop an anxiety disorder for the first time tonight. So that was really...
But they will recognise it in themselves.
Already have it, they'll recognise it and say, oh, wow, that was interesting, and now I must do something. But you really asked, does talking about it create it? And...
Well, not create it so much, but reinforce it.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
I mean, we've all been talking about the issue that it's what you think about an event, not the event that causes such distress. And the real thing is to learn the skills of managing the inside of your head and managing some tolerance for the physical symptoms and managing the ability to confront the feared situations with a funny hat on and find that it wasn't worth worrying about anyway.
Hmm. And Sarah, the just get on with it school of thinking, you know, the tough love people who might be watching this and just think, oh, for goodness sake.
I think that there are a lot of people who deny anxiety, and males in particular, and perhaps sometimes older males, who feel very uncomfortable and sometimes feel terribly embarrassed to come to therapy and to acknowledge that they've got a problem. And I think one of the important things about programs like this, and particularly having people like Simon, who's obviously successful, recognised, fairly popular person, coming out and saying, no, this is part of life and, you know, we all have it to a degree, talking about it, making it, I guess, part of the normal thing that people experience will help us to, I think, to depathologise it, and I think that's a really important thing.
Well, I mean, you see so many people... We live in a culture of being in control. You always got to be in control. You've got to have the right car. You've got to be on... Your career's got to be on track. And basically, for most people, it's a facade. At the end of the day, you just got to face the fact that life is full of the good, the bad, and the ugly, and that's what makes the whole picture of it.
From the good, the bad, and the ugly to the unusual.
It's our love that keeps the three of us strong. He means everything to me, and I'm not looking for any other man. Belle and I, when we go out, we tell them that we're both Mark's wives.
We'll be back next week.